الأبحاث العلمية للمؤتمر الماجستوما. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. We are pleased to start our scientific sessions this morning on maestoma. Please lock your mobile phones. This first opening session is about the history of maestoma, and I am pleased and privileged to introduce to you our first speaker, Professor Sheikh Mahjoub. It's not difficult to introduce an eminent scientist of the caliber of Professor Sheikh. He started his association with maestoma, as I remember, some 50 years ago. It was in the early 60s, I think. We together were house surgeons and registrars at the time. He took the line of mycology, and we went into other routes. And together with his colleague, then I think it was Ian Murray, they worked in Medini Hospital, in Khartoum Hospital, seeing patients, taking samples, and in collaboration with the School of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene, they produced their famous monograph on maestoma, the serology of maestoma at the time. And then he came back here and established the maestoma clinic in Khartoum North Hospital and started chemotherapy on maestoma and produced original work on that. He published his work, and ever since then people have been trying to treat maestoma with chemotherapy and find ways out of surgery to the maestoma. Professor Sheikh, in addition to his maestoma work, he has taken other jobs. He has worked in WHO office in Alexandria as an advisor. He worked as a professor of mycology and microbiology in Saudi Arabia and the Kingdom of Jordan. And a part of medicine, he also took the post of a minister of higher education and research in this country for a while. May I ask Professor Sheikh to come and tell us about the history of maestoma in the Sudan, I think, or perhaps internationally.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, Professor Muhammad Ahmed Hassan. And I think I'm indebted to Muhammad Ahmed. He always introduces me, and it's no surprise. I was his houseman. Well, distinguished visitors, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Well, better to start with the picture of maestoma so that we know what we are talking about. نبذات ولد التصوير. I thought I need some here a little bit. All right. So, you know, it's a chronic disease, progressive, and starts skin infection, subcutaneous tissue, and will ultimately affect bone, which we all try to avoid. It affects the lower limb, the foot in particular. Ahmed Fahal says it affects the left foot more than the right foot. I'm not sure of that. But anyway, to respond to that, I showed the left foot. It may be difficult to talk about my stomach. It's now 170 years or more. To correct Professor Goodfellow, who said 200 years last night. Specifically, I think the first case was published 170 years ago. So I thought I will talk about some important dates where publications made impression on the history of my stomach. And the first of these, there is the first report of Gill in 1842 in Madura Dispensary in southern India. But the early work in India was summed up by Carter in 1864, and he's the one who gave it the name. Mykes means fungus, and Omei, the tumor. He was professor of anatomy and physiology at Grant Medical College in Bombay, and he wanted to distinguish this from other tumors. So there were many names going on at that time, tuberculous disease of India and others, but he is the one who gave it the name Madura foot. The early work, most of the early work, started in India. And in 1874, Carter published his monograph on mycetoma, or the fungus disease of India. He gave full account of early case records and the work of his contemporaries, Godfrey and the others at that time. And he beautifully illustrated descriptions of mycetoma and emphasized its fungal nature. Early depicted the fungus now known as Madurella mycetomae or Madurella mycetomatis, if you see the drawings of Carter at that time. Boyce and Servier in 1894 show that the black and white varieties were independent entities and that many of the pale grain types were caused by actinomycetes rather than fungi. Very important distinction. Vincent in 1894 reinforced the idea of actinomyces being one of the types of causal agents by isolating an organism which he named Streptothrix maduri from yellow grains in India, in Algeria. And that's the work of the Pasteur Institute in Algiers, Morocco, Abidjan at that time. By the end of the 19th century, the initial phase of discovery was over and the phase of consolidation set in. Brumpt, 1906, described the fungus isolated from black grains for which he created the new binomial Madurella mycetomae. Now we call it mycetomatous. The species went through different names, but the genus remained the same. A fungus that has since proved to be the most important single cause of mycetoma in the world. Pinoy, 1913, was the first to study the actinomycotic agents. Chalmers and Archibald, 1916, from Sudan, for the first time classified mycetoma into actinomycetoma and eumycetoma, which we use up to now. Very important distinction. 1927, Gamel presented an elaborate review of species known up to that time. And so did McKinnon from Uruguay, who also for the first time, together with Vidal, describe Madurella Grisea as an agent of mycetoma from South America and its differences from Madurella mycetomatis. The publication by Gamil is a very authentic and contains many names of organisms up to that time. Most of the early studies were conducted in India, but by the beginning of the 20th century, notable scientific studies shifted to Africa, particularly the Sudan and Pasteur institutes located in some countries of Africa. We think now the highest endemicity of mycetoma is in Sudan. Grantham Hill, the general surgeon in Khartoum Civil Hospital, published an excellent paper on clinical aspects and surgical approach to mycetoma and actinomycetoma in 1931. You will see, when you read that paper, you will see very little has been added since. Peter Abbott, a surgeon in Wad Madani Civil Hospital up to 1954, was awarded the MD from Cambridge University on clinical and epidemiological studies of mycetoma. He also addressed the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene in London in December 1956 on mycetoma of the Sudan. Abbott carried in vitro trials with antibiotics. He found that the growth of Madurella mycetomae was unaffected, while Streptomyces somaliensis was markedly sensitive to antibiotics. Regarding surgical treatment, Abbott reaffirmed the significance of either removal of the tumor in toto, or if its borders is ill-defined, a margin of healthy tissue is removed as well to guard against recurrence. New agents of mycetoma were reported by Segretta from Pasteur Institute in Paris and his colleagues in 1959-1961 from Senegal. He described Leptospira senegalensis and new Testudine rosettii. Gonzalez Ochoa and Hoyes from Mexico have reported on serological relations. Now this is a new era. Serological relations between pathogenic actinomyces in 1953. Zamora and Bokhalil and Pastariccia have followed this in 1962 by defining specific polysaccharides that distinguish between Nocardia asteroides and Nocardia brasiliensis. I followed this using immunodiffusion in 1964. We described serodiagnosis of mycetoma agents. Gonzalez Ochoa described mycetoma caused by Nocardia brasiliensis and isolation of the organism from soil. With our friends, the Mexicans, we seem to exchange ideas even at that time. J.B. Lynch, professor of pathology and faculty of medicine, University of Khartoum, at the time of his retirement, gave a Hunterian lecture, which is a distinguished lecture, to the Royal College of Surgeons of England on mycetoma in the Sudan, where he gave a beautiful report on the pathology of both causal organisms and host tissue reactions. This was later obviously verified by Professor Hassan. Through cooperation between the Minister of Overseas Development of the United Kingdom, initiated by Professor Julian Taylor, Professor of Surgery, University of Khartoum, and Dr. Ian Murray of the Mycological Reference Laboratory, London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, Ministry of Health Sudan, and University of Khartoum, the mycetoma clinic and wards were established in Khartoum North Civil Hospital in the Sudan under my leadership in 1968. Availability of patients and technical capabilities of the team in charge made it possible to carry out further research on serological diagnosis, Mahjoub and Jum'a, Mahjoub later, McLaren, Mahjoub and George Coppolis. In the various phases, we started with immunodiffusion, then counter immunoelectrophoresis, and later by ELISA. Al-Hassan al-Mahjoub in 1972 confirmed beyond doubt for the first time the spread of mycetoma through the lymphatics. We found that something like 2% of patients may have spread of the lesion through the lymphatics. Heinemann Medical Books of London in 1973 published the monograph on mycetoma by myself and Dr. Murray. I hope the second edition will be coming soon. 1975, Aiello, and here Aiello, the wife, not Lee Aiello, to those who know Lee, the late Lee. This was his wife, a microbiologist. Together with, she came here, and others isolated some mycetoma agents from Sudanese soil. It was important to establish this so that we know where these organisms lie, the fungi and the actinomycetes as well. 1976, we published methods for in vitro testing of mycetoma organisms and reported on the medical management of 144 patients with actinomycotic mycetoma caused by S. somaliensis, A. maduri, A. pelletieri. Of these patients, 63% were cured, and I emphasize that, by one or the other of a combination of antibiotics, to which we will refer later when we come to discuss the treatment. 1977, we studied immunological status of mycetoma patients. It's Professor Hassan, Professor Samia, and myself. Our patients showed some deficiency of cell-mediated immunity. These patients did not respond to the MONTU test. They were not sensitized by dichlorobenzene, and their lymphocytes did not reform to lymphoblasts when challenged by phytohemagglutinin. I have no doubt, I mean, we have how many here? 100 people? None of us has a mycetoma. And I think this is mainly the people who get it are the people who have got some deficiency in cell-mediated immunity. Because now, not only the mycetoma patients, we started to see patients with mycetoma who have tuberculosis at the same time, leprosy at the same time, leishmaniasis at the same time, people who had transplants, and all these patients obviously have got depressed cell-mediated immunity. I think this is an important point. I hope, I think we have a researcher now in Ireland who might be working on this, Ahmed. We hope, because I think the ultimate treatment to these patients is not the drugs. If we succeed in immunopotentiation, that might be the result. In 1978, I managed to experimentally produce mycetoma grains in the Nunu mice. And these mice are naturally athymic, and by injecting them in 3 weeks, we got mycetoma grains. And I'm pleased to see that Dr. Ahmed, Abdullah Osman Ahmed, Later, he used other type of mice, and he didn't have to use thymic ones. And I hope we will have some of his presentation sometime. But this confirmed that it is the cell-mediated immune deficiency is the one that plays a great role. 21 years later, after Abbott, I addressed the Royal Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene on my courses of the Sudan. And the same lecture was to the same audience and the same society was also addressed by Professor Fahal 4 years ago. In 1981, we gave the fourth Ian Murray Memorial Lecture to the General Assembly of the British Society of Medical Mycology that met in Cambridge. This society, Dr. Murray and myself were founding members in Manchester in 1964. And when he died, they set up this memorial lecture to be given by somebody and to address different mycoses at the same time. In both meetings, stress was made on the success of medical treatment and serodiagnosis of mycetoma. Success of treatment of mycetoma to Madurella mycetomatis with ketoconazole was reported from Sudan and Saudi Arabia by myself and Dr. Juma. We had Saudi group of patients, we had something like 13 Saudi patients and other Sudanese patients, and this paper, I think it was quoted a lot by many people. Maybe Dr. Hyle would refer to it sometime. Yes. Many cases of mycetoma are still reported from African countries like Mauritania, Mali, by our French colleagues. In 1966 and 1972, Pedro Levi and his colleagues reported on clinical, therapeutic, and epidemiological aspects of mycetoma in Mexico. In their last presentation, they reviewed and reported on 2,105 cases. And we will hear about mycetoma in Mexico from my friend, Professor Oliveri Welsh. I will not preempt your speech, Oliverio. Yes. Almost all scientists from Mexico investigate mycetoma caused by Nocardia brasiliensis, which is the main cause of mycetoma in Mexico. Oliveri Welsh and his co-workers reported on the successful treatment of mycetoma due to Nocardia brasiliensis by amikacin. So this was another step. Second half of the 20th century witnessed increase in international travel as well as increase of immigrants from the southern countries of the globe to the north. Subsequently, mycetoma was reported from the United Kingdom by McKinsey and myself. De Hoog et al. Also reported cases from the Netherlands. There seems to have been a renewed interest in mycetoma by Indian workers since 2000. From all states, particularly the province of Rajasthan and Tamil Nadu, where mycetoma is seen more often. Both number of researchers and interest in mycetoma have increased to the extent that before the end of the 20th century, two international conferences on mycetoma were held. The first was held in Barquisimeto in Venezuela in 1980, the second in Taxco in Mexico in 1987. The beginning of the 21st century, the third international mycetoma conference was held in Khartoum, Sudan, 2002. The fourth in Montreal, Mexico in 2007, and now we are in the 5th international conference in Khartoum again. Hemisytoma group was formed within ISHAM, the International Society for Human and Animal Mycology, in 2006, and I'm prepared to be corrected by Wendy if the date is wrong, for exchange of information and experience and help in identifying or confirming the diagnosis, particularly of U-mycetoma agents. Establishment of the Mycetoma Research Center, where we are now in Khartoum Insoba University Hospital since 1996, Professor Fahal, Professor Hassan and myself, and the collaboration team has facilitated both patient care and research in mycetoma. Various aspects of the disease are studied: mycological, histological, biochemical, epidemiological, immunological, and molecular, as well as research in therapy and social aspects. Professor Fahal will obviously speak in detail about this. All this led to excellent collaboration in research and training of postgraduate students. Now takes place between MRC, scientists in Holland, Belgium, the United Kingdom, and Mexico. So the story of mycetoma continues, and the collaboration increased. This is the new theme, that we have more international collaboration, more focus on certain aspects of the disease than others. With the advent of molecular biology, we have the champions here who are working on the genes of Streptomyces. Wendy and others are working on the genes of Madurella mycetomatis. We look forward to more interesting and useful interventions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sheikh. I think we can call you the father of mycetoma in Khartoum. Our next speaker is Professor Ahmed Hassan Fahal. You have already heard about him. I suppose most of you or all of you would know Professor Fahal. He is one of the disciples of Professor Sheikh. Again, he started in the last century, in the late 70s, on mycetoma. He moved the clinic from Khartoum North to Soba University Hospital and worked in close association with the Soba Hospital and with the Institute of Endemic Diseases under Professor Ahmed Mohamed Al-Hassan. And they, using various new techniques like fine needle aspiration, sonography, immunological, biological investigation, and electronic microscopy, they have added quite a voluminous literature to mycetoma. Apart from mycetoma, Professor Fahal is a professor of surgery, general surgery in the University of Khartoum. He has been the director of the Education Development Center, in which he did quite a lot of work. And right now he is the academic secretary of the University of Khartoum. Professor Ahmed Fahal, please.
حياك الله. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First, I would like to thank you very much for being here this morning. And I would like to thank the Orkaza committee for giving this opportunity to be here and to talk to you about an important subject, and that is the Mycetoma Research Center. Very difficult to speak after Professor Sheikh Mahjoub, but I will try to do my best to give a presentation just as equal as his presentation. Mycetoma Research Center was established in 1991. For that time, Professor Sheikh was not here. The objective of this presentation, it is to highlight the activities, impacts of the Mycetoma Research Center, impacts on patients, families, society, and the medical community in general. The content of this presentation will be, I'll be talking about the establishment of the center, the justification for establishing this center, and then we're going to talk about the objective of the Mycetoma Research Center at Soba Hospital here. The achievement has been done during the last few years, and then we're going to talk about the future plan of our the center for how to improve the care of mycetoma patients. As you know, mycetoma, as mentioned this morning, it is a chronic specific granulomatous subcutaneous infection caused by true fungi or by higher bacteria, and hence it is classified as EU and actinomycetoma. We established the center in a small